My name is Jeff Garner, as Larry said. I'm the executive director of King's Community Action Organization. I've been the director since 2011. Actually was hired in 2006, so I've been with the agency for 17 years. Lifelong resident here in Hanford, and so definitely I was kind of one of those few kids in high school where everyone was talking about wanting to go somewhere with brighter and bigger lights. I was always like, no, you know, I want to stay here. I want to build up this community. There's a lot that's awesome about this community. This community helped raise me, helped raise my brother, helped raise my family. So I wanted to find a way to give back. My wife's also from Hanford, so that was the game plan. You know, once we got married, is we wanted to be here in Hanford. And so as part of today's presentation, as Larry mentioned, I definitely do want to share out with the community a pretty large project that we've been working on, probably close to 6-7 months now. Maybe go back a little bit, kind of from a scatter standpoint, but from a project concept standpoint, probably about 6-7 months is when we started to formulate this concept that I wanted to share with you today. So I know Larry mentioned to me, which is great, there's a video on YouTube from the Community Action Agency in San Luis Obispo. So I won't go too deep into the weeds, but pretty much every county has a Community Action Agency. And we got started back in the 1960s. And a lot of our agencies, you go throughout the state or throughout the country, you're going to find a community action agency. So our counterpart in San Luis Obispo, they developed a shelter, I think back in 2016, maybe 17. And so it really has helped to serve as a model. One, they've lived through it. So they kind of tell us, hey, here's the good, bad, and ugly of it. So, you know, do this or don't do that. So that has been helpful. So there is this model, it's called 40 Prado, that's the name of their shelter. So I think it would be good, I mean it is a kind of a model, I won't say it's a mirror image of what we're wanting to do, but it is something that we have been looking at. We actually took a tour of this facility with our board members, some city officials, to say, all right, you know, because a lot of times when you're talking about something versus when you see something, it just kind of comes off differently. And so the art tour was very helpful. So hopefully this video here is helpful as well in terms of just trying to kind of put the meat on the bone in terms of what does a low barrier shelter look like.
Just opened in November of 2018, 40 Prado is able to deliver 24-hour-a-day comprehensive services to both homeless and those at risk of homelessness here in San Luis Obispo.
We've been volunteering here at Dining and Life for about 3 years, maybe a little longer. We just help clients check in. We have them with any of the needs they have for shampoo, deodorant, razor.
An additional expanded service that we provide are kennels for those clients who have non-service animal dogs and even cats and can't bear to part with them. This now allows our participants who consider their loved ones to be family to have a safe place for them to kennel. Hi, I'm Grace McIntosh. I'm the director here at 40 Prado. We have 100 beds available for men, women, and children with separate families. Children's Room is a collaboration between Capsule's Head Start and Early Head Start and the San Luis Obispo Office of Education. This room is intended to support parent-child relationships by strengthening interactions, assisting parents in using any moment as a learning opportunity, and encouraging bonding time for parent and child. In addition, home-based services are provided to the parents and child. The teacher meets with the family. Due to the generosity of the San Luis Obispo City employees, we now have a wonderful community garden. Redwood boxes were installed with wonderful varieties of vegetables, fruits, lettuces, and even flowers that were planted and continue to feed our community kitchen.
Homelessness touches many in the community. This is someone's daughter, son, mother, father, brother or sister, or friend. 40 Prado is the result of the San Luis Obispo community coming together to create not only a state-of-the-art building, but services not found anywhere else in the county. These intensive services are all provided on-site by participants by providing access to not only basic support, such as food and shelter, but even medical, mental health, substance misuse, and financial readiness support, so that they can not only become housed, but stay successfully housed.
So that is a video that is on the county website for San Luis Obispo. And so that is the shelter that they operate, considered a low barrier shelter in San Luis Obispo. The county's pretty big, so I know they have another shelter. They kind of split the county up into sections, but that is, I believe, their largest shelter that they have. And again, because we're a similar type of agency, they've been very gracious to us in terms of giving us tours. Our architect that we plan on using for the project, he visited the site last week, I believe it was, or 2 weeks ago, but very recent. And they've offered, share blueprints, share whatever information that they feel would be helpful as we go down this path here in Kings County. So let me kind of backtrack a little bit and just kind of go through kind of the genesis of how this all kind of came about from our side of things and our involvement in the community. And so, we are an agency with a very clear mission that our responsibility that we see it and that I believe the community sees it is our goal is to help advance individuals, families, and communities. And there are individuals that we serve, families that we serve that might need a little bit of assistance for the day. There are some families and individuals that we serve that might need a lot of assistance, a lot of time and resources. But our goal is we are going to help advance those individuals, families, wherever they are at. We want to work to better them, which ultimately betters our community. We want to have a healthy, robust community. So when we were kind of brainstorming what are the next steps for us at KCAO, really, first and foremost, that jumped to the front of the line was we needed a new food bank here in Kings County. We've been operating the food bank, KCAO, since the mid-1980s. And currently, right now, we are leasing space to an amazing landlord, the city of Lemoore. They've been awesome. And we've been there since 2010. And it's the old Candlewick factory there on Cinnamon. So when we moved in, we were the only people in there. I mean, it was a ghost building. And so we spruced it up, our part of the building. And then all of a sudden, the city of Lemoore, they came in, started using every square, really inch of the building. And we were maxing out our space. And so Nathan and I, we would be sharing conversations about the fence line, how far we could expand the fence, how much we could push it in. But they've been really great to us. But it has come to us very clearly that we need a larger location. Before Lemoore, we were in Ramona. Our space was about 4,000 square feet. In City of Lemoore, the old Kenwood building, we're just a sliver of it. We're about 12,000 square feet. So we needed a bigger building. Because for our food bank world, it's not about 100 or 1,000 pounds. We are giving and distributing and receiving 1.5 million pounds of food per year. And so we have large trucks coming in, large trucks going out, where we are handing and providing food out to the community. So we are more of an exporter and importer. property and then build upon that. So the food bank was kind of that first priority that we were looking at. Then the second priority that came out for us was a centralized kitchen, because we do operate 14 preschool locations throughout Kings County. And all of these centers, some have very small kitchens, some have a little bit larger kitchens, but we feel like it's not the most efficient way to provide good quality food to our little ones that are there at our centers. So we wanted to have a centralized location that we can prepare the meals in large quantities, get those meals out through a transportation system that's able to deliver to those sites. You see it, school districts do it all the time. So we thought that would be a good approach for us as well. But also having a centralized kitchen would help, because we do have a nutrition program where we educate and inform low-income families about healthy eating, healthy choices, smart shopping. And so we thought having a centralized kitchen would be an educational classroom that we can bring in families, do meal preparation. They can come in, they can learn how to cook or prepare meals in different ways. So we wanted to do that as well. So then it kind of branched off. We have a food bank, we have a centralized kitchen. So then, you know, in terms of square footage, we felt like that could fit within the 50,000 square feet. But then as we have been involved in serving the homeless population in Kings County since 1983, we've been involved in seeing, you know, unfortunately, the growing number of homeless individuals in our community. And we also serve, we have a spot on the collaborative. There's a Kings County Homelessness Collaborative that's made up of 16, 17 different agencies and businesses. The idea is to try to say, what are we going to do here? You know, what are we going to do to change our landscape in our community? So one of the goals that was set by that collaborative, made up of city, county, local businesses, agencies like ourselves, was to develop a low barrier shelter. And so I'm definitely going to get into exactly how that definition goes when we say low barrier shelter. So we know this thing was kind of saying, all right, well, you know, that's been identified as a need, that's been identified as a way to address that need. So then we thought at KCAO, because it kind of naturally folks look to us based on our experience, based on our resources that we have, that we would be the ones that would operate the shelter. Because currently we are operating the larger shelter in Kings County today. So the thought was that we would be the best suited to do that. And I do agree with that. I do feel like we have the capacity, we have the knowledge, we have the partnerships and connections. So then we thought, okay, well, if we're going to build a food bank, we're going to build a centralized kitchen, and we're going to build a shelter, it is not in good financial sense to do two different locations. And then we really started to think, how can we merge these items, these services, these programs together? So that's where the concept came about of a KCAO Food Bank and Service Center that would have all of these programs and services under one roof on one central campus. And the idea with that is we would be able to maximize our resources, be able to overlap the programs and services that are provided by one to the other. And so we thought that would be the best approach to take. So the idea of the low barrier shelter came on board really after the food bank and centralized kitchen was really first developed, and then we brought on the low barrier shelter. So let me kind of dig into a little bit more of kind of the you know, just to make sure, like, defining what those program names mean. So let me go back to the food bank real quick on that. I know a lot of times, because I realize when I'm talking to folks in the community, when I'm saying food bank, they're kind of connecting it to a food pantry. So you kind of have three levels of food service in our community. You have prepared meals, which I would say you can think of the soup kitchen on Downey Street. They prepare meals on a daily basis for individuals. We don't do that. Then there is a food pantry. So food pantry would be like the Moore Christian Aid. Koinonia Church has one. St. Vincent de Paul is another one, where they have a smaller footprint. I would almost say like a building this size or room this size, where it kind of almost looks like a grocery store. Folks would come in and they would get a box or a bag of food to kind of bridge them over to the next day, to the next week. And so those are smaller footprints, and they have their own operating system. USDA. USDA then transports the food back to us. So we have this food coming in. So when we get the food, we send it out to local food pantries or other community partners, and then they distribute the food on under their own banner. Now they'll say, yeah, this food is from KCAO, but they're the ones delivering the service. So that is kind of the breakdown of the food bank. I just want to clarify that. Centralized kitchen, I think that's pretty clear cut as to what that is. So let's talk about low barrier shelter. Let's talk about the functions of a low barrier shelter and a navigation center. So those are probably some words that you guys have heard. And I think we have to get away from assuming that everyone knows what those are, and we don't. I mean, even to my own team, we're constantly talking about what those two things mean. So let me first talk about low barrier shelters. So there are in the shelter world, there's low barrier shelter, and then they're not technically a high barrier shelter. They just say low barrier or regular shelter. So a regular shelter is kind of what we're operating now. We operate the Barbara Seville shelter. Is anyone familiar with the Barbara Seville shelter? So we've been operating that shelter since 1983. I think we've done a really good job with that shelter. Probably so good that probably many of you don't know where it is. And that's exactly how we want it. It is a shelter that focuses on individuals, men and women, who are victims of domestic violence, or women who aren't victims of domestic violence, who are just homeless for other reasons. So we have a 38-bed shelter that we've been operating since 1983. It is a confidential location. It is in a highly dense residential area. And we've been operating that shelter, I think, with great success, since the 80s. And so that has been our track record. And we do have a kitchen there that we prepare the meals on site. And the idea with our shelter is, again, individuals come to us, children, moms, men who are victims of domestic violence, and we meet them where they're at. And then we help to build up that foundation. We build that foundation, and then to think about what does tomorrow look like, and then to start to prepare that plan for them. Now, for us, because we do have children there, you do have victims of domestic violence there, we do have pretty rigorous screening process before folks can come into the shelter. Now, we work with local law enforcement, we work with the sheriff's office, so it is a county-wide shelter, meaning if there's a domestic violence victim in Avenal, that shelter belongs to them. And if there's a homeless individual in Avenal that would qualify, we find a way to bring him to our shelter. The one thing about the Barbara Seville shelter, though, is we do monitor if we feel like someone is under the influence of some type of substance. They are not permitted into the shelter. We'll screen them, we'll interview them, and if they're going to be a harm to themselves or to others, then they are not admitted into our shelter. Now, we still work with them. We might do a motel voucher. We might find another maybe shelter resource that's out there in the community or neighboring county. We will try to connect them to something, but in terms of our shelter operated, we don't place it there. So that does not make us a low barrier shelter. What a low barrier shelter is you pretty much open your doors to individuals that are struggling with homelessness, and you bring them in, and as long as they can function to where they can listen to your instructions, follow your instructions, they are able to come in. So you create this low barrier where there has to be a very challenging situation why they could not be at the shelter. So a low barrier is kind of a wider gate that allows individuals but some, and hey, we have an empty apartment for you to move into tomorrow, they're not ready. They're not ready to move into that apartment. Either they can't afford it, they're not going to get all the right paperwork, they might not have the right ID. So there are things you've got to build up, and that's where the Housing Navigation Center comes in, is you work and you build up a plan to help those individuals. But a Housing Navigation Center also serves a greater community, meaning that you don't have to stay at the shelter in order to receive housing navigation services. So housing navigation centers often are set up where someone can come in, take a shower, they can come in, get a meal, they can come in and get their mail. So if there is someone who just, for whatever reason, is not coming to the shelter, not wanting to stay at the shelter, there are services through the Housing Navigation Center that they can utilize. And really the idea is that you can give them a sense of hope, you can give them a fresh shower, give them some decent clothes to where they are now integrating into our community, where we don't have that first impression of, oh, well, this person must be homeless. And it's someone that is now within our community, and then, you know, having them have a pathway, hopefully, to advance as they go down this journey. So let me go into a little more details. I know that is, because I do feel, I don't want to put words in your mouth, but the food bank concept seems to be, for the most part, pretty well received. I mean, I think we can all sit there and say, I mean, we've all gone to the grocery store very recently, and costs are very, very high. So when you think of seniors, when you think of individuals or households with children, it is very challenging. It's very, very challenging for folks to afford food for their family. We also do the summer food program for our food bank, so we do a lot of food programs. So I do feel like that part of it has gone, you know, I think very or positively received. Centralized kitchen, I think, is kind of a function that connects well to a food bank. So I think that has been pretty well received as well. It is a big question of lower area shelter and navigation center, and I get it. As someone, as I mentioned, you know, born and raised in Hanford, I can maybe think of one or two people that I would see as a child that was homeless. One person I thought was homeless wasn't. He lived in a house just down the road, but he would always kind of hang out at the grocery store on the outside of it. But he wasn't homeless. He had a place to go, but that was me, you know, looking and thinking that person was homeless. But now we look, and there is homeless. There is homeless individuals. I don't want to say every corner of our streets, but there are homeless individuals. There's remnants of homelessness that you see, shopping carts, tents, a pile of clothes that are there. So unfortunately, that number is growing, and we do want to do something about it. We have to do something about it. At one point, and I get it, you know, it's almost like, well, maybe if we just kind of lay low, the problem will kind of pass by. And I was at one point thinking that might happen too, and it didn't. And we've seen these numbers continue to grow. And just in the most recent survey that was done in our county, it's called a point-in-time study, where agencies go out and for one day you survey, do a head count of all the homeless individuals that are either sheltered or unsheltered. And so those who are considered street homeless, that number in Hanford doubled. It doubled from 2022 to 2023. It just doubled in 1 year. So for us, you know, what we're seeing is the lack of doing nothing is not reversing those numbers. And so we do want to try to make an attempt to have individuals have the opportunity to be in a location that we can connect with them and try to get them to advance. Try to get to advance, even if it's a small victory. They get their ID, or they get a mailbox set up, or they get instead of having the scattered population of homeless individuals, you have more of a central location that they can be at, and then now it's up to us to help connect with them and make them to help them advance. We do feel like having a location will help to reduce the number of individuals who are street homeless. Just doesn't mean because we have a location means everyone's going to go to it. We understand there's going to be rules that we have that they're not going to like. There's going to be confrontations that we are going to tell them that, you know, maybe you need to take a little bit of a break from our location. Those things are going to happen. But we do feel like our setup is going to be and put the community in a place where these individuals can at least go to that location and not set up shop in front of a store, on the street, on the corner. So we feel like that's a big help by having that one location. Another big thing to think about is, and I don't know if you guys have heard about the legal case, Martin versus Boise. So I'm not a lawyer, but reading up on it, my understanding of it and talking with like Chief Sever here in Hanford is, so in 2018, I believe it was, there was a case. It actually went all the way up to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court did not wish to hear it, so they took the ruling of the Ninth Circuit, the appellate court. And pretty much what the ruling said was the city of Boise was trying to enforce local ordinances that said homeless individuals can't sleep in parks, they can't sleep on sidewalks, they can't sleep in public areas, they can't be there in public areas. The city has the ability to move them off, move them to somewhere else, or just tell them to leave. There was a lawsuit that was filed, and what the courts ruled was that any city in that Ninth Circuit, so you're talking Idaho to California, I don't know if it goes all the way over to Hawaii, but if a community is trying to enforce local ordinances, meaning how many, you know, can you sleep in the park, can you be in the Civic Center park, can you do those things as a homeless individual, the court says if the community doesn't have enough shelter beds available, then you cannot force those local ordinances. And actually, I'm going to try to quote it correctly. So they said here, they wrote in their opinion, the court, Ninth Circuit, as long as there is no option of sleeping indoors, the government cannot criminalize indigent homeless people for sleeping outdoors on public property on the false premise they had a choice in the matter. That was their ruling. And then so they went on to say that according to the Ninth Circuit, this principle compels the conclusion that the Eighth Amendment of the Constitution, which falls under cruel and unusual punishment, prohibits the imposition of criminal penalties for sitting, sleeping, or lying outside on public property for homeless individuals who cannot obtain shelter. So in other words, just as a city may not criminalize being homeless in a public place, it also may not criminalize conduct that is unavoidable of being homeless. So that is now then what kind of strapped and handcuffed local cities, is that they couldn't enforce their local ordinances.
Can I ask a little
question? Not yet. Okay. So what it told them is, you know, thinking about the city of Hanford, is if you don't have enough shelter beds, which at the time, I mean, still today, we have approximately our shelters, 38 beds, King's Gospel Mission, I don't know exactly how many beds they have, but we're probably maybe at 50 or 75, that there's not enough beds that the city can enforce these ordinances. And so it's put the city in a really tough position. So by having a low-barrier shelter where you can have enough beds and you can say, no, there is enough opportunities, enough options for these individuals to go to. If they choose to go to it, it's up to them. But the city now has more options, more opportunities to enforce local ordinances when it comes to policing homeless individuals and maintaining public areas. So that is a big piece to it as well. And that really is really the main reason why our search for a location drew us to Hanford. Because when we were thinking about the food bank and centralized kitchen, we actually bought a piece of property board of supervisors and the city of Hanford said, no, we need it in the city. We need it inside the city of Hanford, because then that will help us enforce these ordinances that they wish to enforce, and also goes back to the Barton versus Boise case. So that really changed a lot for us. So now instead of kind of looking on the peripheral of Hanford, kind of on the outskirts, we had to find something that was truly inside the city boundaries. And so that's where our search took us. And that's why we started to look more into that area. And so we also presented this concept to the Kings County Grand Jury. We shared it with various other groups around the community. And we laid out the concept. Now, the location was still something that was up in the air, but we really thought this concept would work in our community. And so we were able to receive, because we had to apply for grants and money to start to receive funding for this. So we went out, we were able to collect 29 letters of support for this project. Letters of support range from the city of Hanford to Business Health, local churches, Main Street Hanford. So we got kind of a broad range of support for the concept itself of having all three of those components together. So in terms of the location, let me kind of dive into that and kind of how we're right now looking at this location. So I did mention the city of Hanford's request and the board supervisor's request about trying to find something inside the city of Hanford. So so we started to look and started, you know, again looking at if other properties out there that have a big enough building, and we weren't able to find anything. Are there vacant properties out there that would work well for us? We also kind of had other conditions that we looked for the property. We wanted something that was 5 to 10 acres. We needed something inside the city of Hanford. We also wanted something located near major roadways. Because again, we're thinking of our food bank, we're thinking of our centralized kitchen, and so we're going to have this transportation system of trucks coming in and out, cargo vans coming in and out, so we needed somewhere where it was going to extend our drive to get on the main artery. So 198, 43, I guess technically not 41, because that city of Hanford doesn't touch that. So we really tried to look for something that was close to those main arteries. And then also we needed to find something that was zone appropriate, because changing the zoning, I mean, it's not impossible, but it's not the easiest thing to do. So we needed something that was zoned correctly as well. And then also another thing that kind of came up when we proposed the Armona location as a potential site was, you know, we did hear from several folks about making sure the location was in a vicinity where the homeless individual, one, could access walking, obviously, but then also having access to local services that aren't provided by KCAO. So, Adventist Health, county services, anything that kind of in that Hanford area, we needed something that was close enough where they needed to travel there and come back. It wasn't this faraway distance to where they wouldn't be able to come to the shelter or be able to go back to the services they were looking for. So we did look at a couple of locations. So I'm just going to kind of run down these various locations that we kicked the tires on. And some kicked more than others, and others were pretty, you know, sometimes a quick no, but these are things that we did consider. So let me tell you what looks outside of Hanford, just to show kind of the brainstorming that went into this before the request came in to be inside the city. So I mentioned the Oak Avenue, Kuhn Avenue property in Armona, so that's a property that we were looking at. We also look at the home garden community. There's an old Barton's High School. So we were looking at that. We're looking at that for our food bank, some offices, some centralized kitchen, but we did feel like it was large enough to have a low barrier shelter if we were to go down that path as well. As for Hanford, what we were looking at, we did consider the old Orchard Supply Hardware building as a possible location. We did look at the old Smart and Final building and property. So we looked at that as well. It was pretty small, but that would only be for a shelter. We didn't move forward on that. We also looked at, there was a vacant piece of property on 9th and 1/8th Avenue off of Highway 198 and 3rd Street, so kind of in the vicinity of Overland Stockyards. So we were kicking the tires on that one. That property was owned by the state, and so we were just kind of discussing with them, but that kind of got shelved, so we didn't pursue that. And I don't know if it would be a big enough location, but that was one that we considered. We also looked at Shepherd Drive and Hume, and I don't know if any of you have been out there recently. Yeah, it is, it's just kind of a different world. And so when someone told me to go out there, someone who I respect a lot, and they say, go out there, that would be a potential location. So driving out there, so it's down 11th Avenue, you go south on 11th, and then you make a left on Hume. It's a residential area, and then there's a kind of a frontage road, I guess, Shepherd. And there's already a homeless encampment out there. I mean, you got trailers, you got tents, you got a lot of people out there. And so when we were out there looking, folks who use that facility came up to us, talked to us, told us, one, they kind of wanted to know what we were doing there, and they kind of shared kind of what they do out there, and they, it sounded like they had their own little community. But I asked them, I said, do you guys get pushed back here from, I mean, houses are right across the street, and they said no, because, I call this guy the mayor, because he seemed like he knew all the rules of what goes on there. He says, no, we pretty much say, don't touch those things, because as long as we don't bother them, they're not going to bother us. So I don't know how long they've been there. My understanding is it used to be county property. It's one of the county islands. So the sheriff department, there was issues of homeless individuals. They would kind of move them out there. And then I think earlier this year, it just got annexed into the city of Hanford. So now the city is now managing that location. Managing meaning like it's now under their umbrella. There are no services that are being provided out there. But that was one location. reach out to this this church and ask if they would be interested in selling, and they said, yeah, we'll consider it, and let us kind of talk amongst ourselves in terms of what we can do. And so right now, there is nothing there. I think you've got three C trains there. You have this parking lot that's here. You've got the railroad tracks here. In one of the C trains, because the owners, the current owners, say, go look at the C train, see if you want to keep it. We looked at it, and there's actually a homeless individual in the C train. So there are, I mean, we know, I mean, you just drive by it now. I mean, you have remnants of the homeless community that is in this area. And it really is almost as far west as we can get that is considered the city of Hanford. It's almost as far west as we can get. And it's on the main artery, 198. It is 5 acres, so it just barely gets over the bar in terms of the space. And to us, there was more kind of these natural barriers. You got a railroad track, you got ag land there, you got a highway there. So we thought that this would be the spot that we should look for to create as least amount of impact for our community, but also have the best space and location-wise to go forward with the project. So that's the gravitational pull that got us here. We started there, and then we worked our way west. Now, as a part of this agreement, or this proposal that we gave, there are some conditions on this. One, we got to make sure we need to do an environmental report. We got to make sure. I've only been in Hanford since 1980, so I don't know what was on here before that. I don't know what was underneath the ground. So we're doing environmental stuff just to make sure everything is good from that standpoint. We also, we are currently working with our architect. So for this project concept that we've been talking about and planning for, we want to double, triple check located the San Luis Obispo shelter, kind of the setup. And that is the approach we're going to take as well, where our goal is when that design comes about, we want people to test what the building is. We don't want them to feel like, oh, well, you can tell that's a shelter. We want to have that value of how it looks. We do feel like having the joint use facility, it's going to have more of the footprint of the food bank and the kitchen than it will the shelter. And so we are mindful of that. And so in terms of how it's laid out, we want to, our name's going to be on the building. We want it to look the best that it can look as well. It will be gated, so it will be completely gated. We're at a property ground, so this one will be completely gated. There'll be one way in, one way out. We will have staff there 24/7. We will look to have security there. We'll have necessary cameras to keep the property located secure. We will sweep the property on a frequent basis, so not only what's inside the fence area, but in the kind of surrounding areas as well, because we do want to be good neighbors, and so we want to make sure that if there are anything that's out there that doesn't need to be out there, then we want to make sure that we take care of that. We have a great relationship with the city of Hanford, King County Sheriff's Department, so we will count on their support and their help as well to address some of those issues that will pop up, which pop up, you know, already at some of our some other locations. And so those things are natural. So we feel we'll have their support as well. And then lastly, so the one thing about the shelter in San Luis Obispo, they have a kitchen and shelter combined. We are going to have a food bank, so that is going to be a unique feature to it. We feel by having all of those things together, we are going to set up a program that encourages and incentivizes those who are utilizing the low barrier shelter to be involved in the upkeep of this facility. We're going to teach them how to drive a forklift. They're going to help us warehouse, take food off trucks, load the food up. They're going to work in the kitchen. They're going to do the laundry. They're going to help us clean in and outside the building. We know that idle hands aren't good. We need them to be involved. We need them to wake up with a purpose. And we feel like having a location like that, that type of arrangement, it starts to advance them. And that's what we want. You know, they're not going to get to 1 to 100 overnight, but we need them to advance. And our goal is that they won't need us one day. And they can move on. And they have something that's more secure, more reliable than the life they were living prior to utilizing the location. So I think I covered everything. If I miss anything, I'll definitely jump back in. But thank you, Larry. I know I took a little too much time, but
no, that's fine.
It's a big project.
We'll definitely have some questions from the public. Let me start because I'll never get this microphone back. All right, so first of all, do you have the funding already allocated to build it and operate it?
We do not. So as I mentioned, right now the price tag is $14 million. We right now have about $6 million that we've either received or has been pledged to help support it. So that's just to build it, $14 million. To operate it, now we're thinking again, food bank, kitchen, low barrier shelter, housing, navigation center. We're thinking that's going to be an annual operating cost of $1.5 million. And really the big cost of that is it's 24/7. We experience a high cost right now at our Barbersville shelter. That costs $600,000 to operate, and that's 38 beds. Because really, I think of economy of scale. If you have one person at the shelter or 200 people, well, let's say one person or 50 people, you still only need one staff person probably. You know, and so it's that economy of scale that we really are trying to get to. So operating-wise, no, we are not even at halfway to where we would be ready to go.
All right, next question. How many beds is in the plan in the works?
So we are looking at doing 150 beds, 150 to 200. We're really kind of asking our architect to say maximize the space for us. We are wanting to do a congregate shelter. So a congregate shelter would be like a dormitory. So you saw that with San Luis Obispo. You would have bunk beds. You would have a separate room for men, separate room for women. They would have a little bit larger than a shoe bank, but enough of a box where they can store it underneath their bed. The bunk beds would have spots. Our shelter right now, the plan is not to have family rooms for it. We are not planning for that. We feel like for families, we would continue to use motels, which we do now. If it's a mom and children, they can use our Barbersville shelter.
site that you're choosing is going to be large enough for future expansion. From what you say, I like the idea of the 40 Prado of San Francisco there. I'm just worried that you're going to run out of space very soon. And so, therefore, you might be looking at a piece of property that's too small for you for future use. Another comment I have, a thought, is the pedestrians that are going to be attending your clients. There's not really a good street system, sidewalk, say. They tend now to use their railroad tracks as their avenue of transportation, and that's very dangerous. I've been on 12th Avenue and had to stop because somebody's pushing a cart across the railroad tracks. That's going to increase many times over. That's really a concern and very unsafe for your clients. They're not going to walk down to a small drive, and to cross there by McDonald's and Chili's. They're not going to do that. They're going to take the shortest route, and they're going to be going back and forth day and night. A major issue. You may be opening up some problems there. And I don't know other than for a pedestrian. How do you get to that facility?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Oh, well, thank you, Bob. So, first part about worrying, yes. There's many things that keep me up at night, and that is one of those things. As you think about this location, you know, is it big enough, one, for what we want to do now, and then big enough to where if we needed to expand, we could. Now, just kind of show my cards here. We have thought, well, you know, if we got this, then maybe down the road get this, then that maybe changes it. But I mean, that's, you know, scratching a lottery ticket, hoping for the best. So, yes, that is one thing, honestly, that worries us. And that's why we want our architect to be involved and give us an assessment to say, what can we do on this property? So that is to the first part of your question. Your second part, good question. And we are thinking about that now. So you're right. You got the railroad tracks here, which, all honesty, individual probably walk now. So you will have, but that's not what we're going to be encouraging. You do have that frontage road on 13th Avenue that then winds into Glendale. So at this moment, that is the pathway we see for individuals coming and utilizing the location. But we do want to work, you know, and when we go through the building permit process in the city of Hanford, they might have some ideas too on working with Caltrans. But right now, that would be the pathway would be going down 13th Avenue. And I think that challenge is also kind of lend itself to why this location was even considered, is because it is off the beaten path. And when we were hearing from the community, you know, they said, don't put something inside downtown. Don't put something in North Hanford. Don't put something close to a big business. Put something that's pushed away. So that's where we started trying to say, right, how far can we go west? How far can we go north, south, east? And for the west side, this is as far west as we can get. So that's how that came to that. So the problem is kind of the solution there, too.
Good question, Bob.
Okay. I'm turning this into Jeopardy, okay? So here's a question. Okay, Jeff, have you contacted the residents that are west of that? For example, have you contacted Craig and Debbie True? Have you contacted Yolanda and Solario Neighbor? Have you contacted Catherine and Richard Lim, or Lance and Kelly Robbins, or Teresa and Ron Martinez, or Brett and Cheryl Blanks, or Rex and Karen Buck, or Joseph Velasquez, or Michael and Arlene McConnell, which I think are the ones that used to own the condo?
Right, yeah.
On those particular properties, me taking and looking up my stuff, I see that being between $6 and $7 million worth of property just west of that. That I feel like this is going to hurt their values. Have you contacted them?
We have not. And the reason why we haven't contacted them was because we had nothing that was final.
Okay.
And so, really, with the property that we had purchased in the past, we, knowing with escrow, things can go south. So we didn't have anything to say, hey, this is going to happen, we're ready to go. So no, but that is part of our outreach plan, is to have those conversations. And with any community resident that is in that
is building small, probably apartments or whatever, over in their loan they just took out in May of, just both of these have been in 2028. Their loan is for $20,800,000. You haven't contacted them?
No, because we didn't know.
Okay. Okay. There is in that area on Garner/13th Road between there and 13th Avenue, there is 47.19 acres there that is undeveloped. And putting that out there, I feel like it's going to destroy or hurt property values for the vacant landowners there. And there's an assortment of people there. You have contact with those, okay. I got like two, okay, or three. As I discussed with you the other day, the owners that have bought property over in that area, such as Emil, that has the hotel over there that in my opinion, is going to be hurt by this. I feel like it's going to destroy that. I feel like, in my opinion, you're going to be hurting the value of future developments for people that have bought land with the intention of developing over there. It's designed to be a commercial area, and bringing homeless people over there is going to hurt it. But have you contacted the car dealerships? Have you contacted AMPM? Have you contacted the hotel and the other people over there? No. Okay. Have you considered selling the three condos that Community Action owns on Greenfield to help come up with additional funds?
No, we haven't. No, but okay. That provides affordable housing for individuals.
Okay, but if selling those condos provides for a lot more affordable housing versus three condos, it just makes sense.
But remember, this isn't affordable housing. This would be the step towards affordable housing.
I understand that, but if it gives you the ability to take and do more, from doing real estate, my opinion is, and I'm trying to turn this one into a question, have you considered the fact that after taking and buying those 5 acres, later on down the road, the neighbors, whenever they know you're looking to expand, the value of that land on them selling it to you is going to skyrocket through the roof, and it's going to cost a lot more?
Right. Well, and I know that will be at any location.
Okay. I would like to talk to you at another time, okay, if you will give me the time to meet.
No, definitely.
Because I've got something you might want to hear.
Okay, thank you, Kimber.
Good questions, Kimber.
I'm going to bring my mic around. Let us know.
in terms of trying to find that right location. And sir, when we were looking at this property, we don't have access to who's buying, who's developing, who owns what. We look at this location. So in terms of your business, I feel like if we don't do anything about our homeless population, then I think a lot of our businesses are going to suffer and have suffered.
That's the last question.
Yeah, but I think locating something like that, like stone's throws away from an $18 million mega project that's coming to this town.
Let's hold on. I got this one over here. That I'm good. Are you good? Okay. All right. I can't miss this speaker. I'm really in trouble.
I just want to know how long the clients are going to be there. I mean, do they only have to stay one night and then they can check out and then they go away for 2 days and they can come back?
No.
There's not going to be like a.
No, you can't. Yeah, you're not able to say you got to stay. You know, so. In terms of like right now, our Barbersville shelter, individuals can stay up to like 90 days. It can be extended if you know, their case plan requires that. So for this, they are able to check in. We'll have some check-in time, so maybe like 8 a.m. to 10 p.m. check-in. But if they want to leave the next day or 3 days later, 5 days later, they can do that.
Okay, and then my second question was, you mentioned that school. What deterred you guys away from that, because that seems like less money, the appropriate facilities, the kind of kitchen. But you were talking about a school out in the garden.
Oh, our
yeah.
So we were close. I mean, we almost had a handshake deal in place, and then another buyer came in.
Okay. I was
yeah.
just
thinking, I mean, it was close.
The kitchen,
it was close.
Yeah. Just,
yeah. Yeah, no, that was kind of what we're looking at. Now, if the client were past, I don't know, and that's where we would have to really kind of consult the city of Cameron. An unincorporated area. So I do feel like given what we know now, that would be off the table.
I'm sure they're on the annex plan if they're not part of the Hanford yet.
Jeff, so I heard you saying kind of over and over that the goal of this project is to help the homeless people to transition out of homelessness. Is that correct?
That's correct.
So then why do I keep hearing you talk about expansion? Is this like a field of dreams thing where if you build it, they will come? And so the people that you transition out, they're just gonna keep getting more and more? I'm not following that.
Yeah, I sure hope not. I mean, right now, our homeless count in the county is over 400. So it has doubled over the last 5 to 7 years. So we do hope that by helping these individuals come into the location, receive services, that slows that growth down. That is our goal. We hope not to expand. But as a little child here in Hanford, I would have never guessed in a million years that we would have over 300 homeless in Hanford. I would have never guessed that. And so I'm hoping that it doesn't get higher and higher. But if you look at the data, it is going higher. And our housing needs, that's what's really struggling here. Right now, the report that was done by the county shows that we need 9,400 more units in Kings County
questions on the Facebook feed. There's a dance studio right there. What are the restrictions for how close it can be to a place where children are gathered?
So, yeah, so far as Target City and Hanford, there's no restrictions.
Okay. Also, talking about the product that's been in business or, you know, since 2018, you would think they'd have data on turnaround time, success rate, how many clients, recidivism rate. You would think that that data is all out there. Are you going to solicit that data before you spend the, what was it, $14 million to build the building?
Yeah, no, we can definitely get that information. And to us, again, our focus too is, again, that balanced approach. Food bank, kitchen, and then that low barrier shelter. So when we say $14 million, if you took out the shelter component of it, it's probably still going to cost us $10 to $12 million. So the food bank is the big footprint on this project. So yeah, we can get that information from San Luis.
How many homeless are in the city of Hanford, did you say?
Based on the point in time study, there are, sorry about that, there are, it's over 300, but I want to give you the exact number here.
So with that shelter, it only, at the maximum, is 200 beds. It's, the city still will be able to force any laws.
So we have...
So it's pointless at the beginning of the city.
So we have talked to the city about that. We've had not direct conversations with their city council, but that is something we are working on with them. And when we first met with them, the idea that the head count or bed count was 150. So as the numbers are going up, yeah, we might have to adjust the plan to cover all of that. Because to them, they do see that as a huge hindrance.
So it needs to be double the size.
It was, yeah. Yeah. So...
So if I made the county, the city, PD said there's 580 homes in Hanford. Yeah.
Yeah, so this study here, which was done in February or March of this year, total in Kings County is 417. In Hanford, there are 310 that were gun sheltered. Yeah, it could be. You had 22 veterans, 39 children. 108 were homeless for the first time, 109 had a disabling condition. That was the numbers there. So yeah, the number, I mean, from when we're planning, that marker keeps jumping.
Right.
And that almost makes us really nervous.
So the city won't be able to foresee the law until there's enough beds.
Well, right, so as we were building out that, because we have to do the building commits and all that, so we probably have to build it to where it does have enough of those beds. And that's what makes it tough on us, as we're trying to, like, tackle this monstrous problem, the problem keeps growing on us, and it's not slowing down. And so,
they should probably figure that out before they try and get more money.
Well, the thing is I wish someone came in and said, boom, 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 here's a big check. It just doesn't happen that way. What happens is, someone will say, here's something here, here's something there, here's something there, and then you're just running around, piecing it together. Well, but our goal is to have that happen, is to match those bed numbers.
All good questions.
Jeff, my understanding is the county fairgrounds has applied for a grant for a homeless shelter also. Do you know how many beds that's supposed to be? Are you guys in communication with them? Is this a joint venture? Because they have it's a several million dollar grant. They're applying to put a homeless shelter on the fairgrounds property.
We have not been in contact with them. They have not contacted us. They have not gone through like the homeless collaborative. So no, we are not aware that they've applied or they've done
it's
that.
Open, right?
Okay. Yeah. So yeah. So I guess I'll have to learn a little more on what that looks like. But no, I'm not aware of that.
Hi. Thanks. So I have a question. I think that helps.
No, please.
Okay, thanks.
entire community? No, I'm not going to say that we did. So no, we haven't done that. But we have put forward the project concept. And now we want to continue to push it out. Like, I want to push it out here tonight, and that's what we're doing. So I will want to hear the feedback and say,
can you possibly follow up with these other locations to see if that's still an option for you to purchase?
Right. And that's, I think, one of the challenges we're having is, you know, if this isn't the right location, which, with all sincerity, I that's a question, but this is not the right location, and we jump to something else, does that become the right location? And that's where I think it starts to become a challenge for us in finding that. And so, some of the locations I did mention, it was received right away, like, no, don't go here. And they cited the reasons. We said, okay, we'll move on. So we have taken that input and have used that to make our decisions. So yes, now can we do that? Yes, that has been the factor that we've used, because we don't
change. So we have to find a better solution.
They don't want rules.
They don't want rules. I have found a better solution. She is homeless, and she does not want anything else but to be that. So if we can make a difference, that would be great. But I don't foresee it for a long time.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you for that. Just to say, I'm going to limit to one question. So we're running out of time. One question per person. I'll get like four or five more that have been waiting. So.
Thank you. Previous lady kind of touched on this a little bit. Appreciate what you guys do. I think it was a great thing. But do you feel like this opening up a facility like this is going to encourage more people to be imported into the area and then starting over again with the laws and being able to enforce the laws? You know, the kind of the whole point of the city getting on board with it. Probably. She's on the right track, a larger area, something bigger that you can keep growing and expanding to if you have to.
No, great question. And I know the city of Visalia is building a shelter that just broke ground. The city of Tulare is building one. So for us, that's encouraging in terms of they will have capacity. So it's not going to be like, move them over here. Kern is building a shelter, or has built a shelter. So yes, I do. I mean, if you just follow the numbers, the data, the numbers are growing. And so we do need to make sure we have space that is big enough to spread out if that time comes. But also, when we think about emergency shelter, I mean, think about like emergency flooding and Corcoran and those types of things. We do need to have also space that we want to think about if folks do have a situation where they need emergency place to stay. We want to have a location like that as well. I don't think that would be a lot of times, but we want to have it. So space is a big issue. And so I want to just keep referencing Bob. That is kind of the worry that we have. We want to explore this site, make sure that we understand what fully is available there.
Hello, my name is Dominique. I have a question for you. When did you actually start this project? And if you do plan to expand, where do you plan to expand?
So it all started again with the Food Bank and Centralized Kitchen. We received the grant funding. We received $1.4 million in 2021. So that's where we started to think about the Food Bank and the kitchen and really thinking of a space kind of like this. The idea of incorporating the Low Barrier Shelter Housing and Navigation Center came about at the end of 2022 because those two things were coming. I mean, it was on a collision course that those two things were going to be happening in our community, so we wanted to combine them. So that's what we did in 2022. Where we would expand to, I know Kimber has shared a location, but we would continue to look for a property that matches our criteria, 5 to 10 acres, zoned for appropriately, has to be zoned correctly, close to a main artery of highway system, and I think that was the other criteria. I don't know if I'm missing anything else. So that's what we'd be looking at. So we'd be
Joseph, then they need to regroup, and then they're welcome to come back. But if that's the behavior they're exhibiting with them, that's not going to happen.
My name's Tom, and the question I've been thinking about for a while since we've been talking about is we're talking about getting them ready to go do other things. This county and Hanford and the surrounding area has always been one of the highest unemployment rates in the state. What are these people going to do?
Yeah, that's a great question, Tom. We struggle with that with the families that we serve with who aren't involved in shelter services.
Right.
There's just not a robust amount of jobs in our community. And so that's where we feel like the skill set that they can at least develop, maybe it's not a job here in the city or the county, but maybe they can take it elsewhere. But we're not in the business of actually creating jobs at this moment, or that's not like one of our programs we offer. But we've realized that we need to provide a skill set for them, so hopefully give them a chance that maybe they don't have a chance before. And so we do feel like a lot of things that we could teach them there at the location, those are transferable skills. I mean, custodial services, warehousing, those are things that I think could advance them to another location. Maybe it is Kings County, maybe somewhere else.
Thanks, Tom.
My name is Lynn Nelson. We keep on talking about rehabilitation. If they can come and go as they please, how do you do that?
Yeah, Lynn, yeah, I know, right? You would feel like you can kind of bring them in and keep them in, but we can't. We legally can't do that. And so what you do is you try to create an environment that is balanced enough where they feel like they can be there, they have some autonomy, but they are wanting to stay there, and then as they stay there, you engage them, and you move them along. That is really what we hope for and what we shoot for.
And how long can they stay there?
So right now, it would be, we haven't set the number of days, but it could be something like 60 days, and then maybe they have to give up their bed and then come back to the next cycle. We haven't yet set that, but we do. But if the individual is showing good progress, we want them to stay there. Well, all with the goal that they're moving off. They're not going to stay there.
That's a good question.
That's a good question. Okay. I want to say one thing.
Yeah.
I'm really ashamed of the city for not doing this, yeah, especially this gentleman here, and not going to him and saying, he came here alone. He started building that project when this was even done. And once again, we have not known about it, and it makes me mad.
That was pretty nice for Lynn.
You are nice, yes.
I do want to say that we're not done yet, but you know, I went to City Council, Board of Supervisors, KCAO, meet KCAO, not I think it's a radio station, but thank you. You know, and I preached, hey, we need to know, we need to have public input, we need to have an opportunity to speak. And I understand that it wasn't time yet because that location's not quite, it's still in escrow. So I get that it wasn't made public until Wednesday. So I get that Jeff reached out to me that night after City Council to come speak. So we've got to give him a little bit of leeway to where it's probably, although the project has been in the works, until there's a location, I don't know that would be the right time to speak about it in public. So I'll give Jeff that. Listen, it's still in escrow, so it does give us an opportunity to have input before it's over. So I don't know that there's a transparency issue yet, because I think that it's about, I mean, what can you say if the property's not bought in? So I'll give him that.
Good evening, Jeff. I know it's late, but if you don't mind if I change the narrative just a little bit. I mean, when we come to the resolve that what we're doing is not working, and I know this is your business, I know this is what you run, and you've done a great job, I know your heart, I
sorry.
Mr. Garner, my name is Ed Gates. And what I asked, you mentioned a while ago about, because it wasn't said so far as to why you had not talked to those people, those neighbors and businesses around that area. So once it's said, though, what good is it going to do to talk to those residents and businesses in that area? And this here should show you how the community feels about that area.
So Ed, we haven't talked to them just because, one, this wasn't a done deal, and it hasn't been a done deal. We do plan on talking with them this month, those individuals or those residents. So we do plan on talking to them. We hope to have a good, constructive discussion with them. I don't know how it's going to go, but we do hope. And just as we kind of have seen with other projects, maybe it is asking us to bounce around to somewhere else, and we have that same conversation with that same other group, and it just will happen again. But we will have those conversations. But we are putting ourselves in a position, trying to put ourselves in a position where we're having some type of response to what we see out on the streets right now. So that's what we're trying to do. But good seeing you, sir.
All right, Jeff, here we go.
I was at the board meeting, KAOC, the radio station, and you had a big picture of President LBJ, Lyndon Baines Johnson, signing the war on poverty. You know the picture I'm talking about?
Yeah,
it's in the book. Okay, that was in 1968. Do we have more problems today than we did in 1968? And if so, why? If your program works.
So yeah, so that what you're talking about. Yeah, so that was actually that was the civil rights bill he was signed. But yes, he did sign the Economic Opportunity Act. Thank God we got it. And so from our standpoint, what we are seeing is that things are difficult for everyone. And a lot of the individuals we serve are working families, a large majority. And so these are individuals who are struggling. They're struggling for child care, struggling to pay rent, struggling to pay medical bills.
Is that my position to have to pay for that? I didn't have those kids. I don't want to take care of them.
I think that's a deeper issue, and maybe we should talk. I'll say Newsom will come out next week. Next week.
Three
months
to cop. And, you know,
I think ultimately they all agree we want something better. We want something better for our community, for our kids, our grandkids. I'm right there. I'm a parent too here in Hanford, so I want something good for them too. So I do appreciate the input. I'm going to leave my business cards. You know how to get a hold of me. Amber, if you get a hold of me. But I do want to hear it. I mean, I'm here tonight, and I wish I was here sooner. I do apologize for that. But I do want that input. Now, maybe we don't always agree on it, and we do factor in input. We have, as it got to this point, and we do want to continue to do that. We want to keep pushing forward. We don't want to slow down. So we want your input. So please share it with us. Okay.
Reach out and try to find some tickets, or maybe Justin, you can bring some next week. Also,